for a while. When you get up in the morning, you see a crazy sign. In your heart for a while. There's a train leaving nightly calling all is said and done. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Keep me in your heart for a while.
Sometimes when you're doing simple things around the house, maybe you'll think of me and smile. You know I'm tied to you like the buttons on your blouse. Keep me in your heart for a while. Hold me in your thoughts, take me to your dreams. Touch me as I'm falling. And I will be right next to you. Engine drivers headed north to Pleasant Stream. Keep me in your heart for a while. These wheels keep turning, but they're running out of steam. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Keep me in your heart for a while.
On behalf of the Kennedy family, I would like to warmly welcome you here today at this unique location chosen as we farewell Horace Charles Kennedy, a special person in your lives. This funeral service is also being recorded for family and friends that cannot be with us here today. I welcome those that can be present as well as those watching. I would like to thank Natalie and Shane for giving me the honour of leading the service. My name is Nikki Boys. We come together today to celebrate Horry's life. Horry was born to Charles and Dorothy Kennedy in Kalgoorlie in 1932, joining his older sister Beth, born 2 years earlier. 8 years later came Lynette, and then baby Isla, 10 years after that. He adored his family, and it was obvious to all that knew him that he was a respectful young man. Horry started his apprenticeship on the 17th of February 1947 under a Mr. Henry Buckland, who said of him that he possessed outstanding qualities. He found him trustworthy, honest, resourceful and dexterous, and stated that he has such great character and that the high level completion of his trade at an early age would see him never look back, and he didn't. He played football, sailed boats, was very popular with his friends and garnered a lot of respect wherever he went and whatever he did. He went on to do national service in the 50s and then headed to England around 1960, where he then met Liz and they married in September 1961. They returned to Australia in 1962 and moved to Carnarvon to work on a plantation. When Natalie and Shane came along, they moved into Carnarvon, when Horry worked as a cabinet maker for many years. In 1978, they decided a change was in order and moved to Geraldton, where Horry got West End Boat Company up and running and for others, and built his reputation as an excellent tradesman. He then went on a few years later to start his own business with a partner and called it Horry and Steve's Slipway. And although he has been retired since the late 90s, it is a testament to his reputation that the business still bears his name. He was very proud that the latest owner was a past employee who shared the same values as himself. Since his retirement, he has enjoyed many extended holidays with his family, travelling most of Australia and challenging himself on difficult journeys throughout the desert regions. He loved all of his time in the bush, but just the same was happy camping at the beach for weekends also, as long as he had his family around. He was happy. For the last 28 years, his children and grandchildren have lived very close to him, most of them on the same property. It has been an absolute joy to him to have watched his grandchildren grow up to adulthood while living so close and being in such constant contact. It has been a bigger sense of joy watching his great-grandchildren do the same and knowing that he is leaving a legacy of family togetherness that is envied by many. Shane, would you like to come forward and share the eulogy?
Thank you. You're going to have to bear with me. Thank you for coming today to all friends and family, and to those he considered family. For those who knew him through work, pastimes, I know that he would have left you funny anecdotes, one or two, and some valuable life lessons. There's an old saying, it takes a village to raise a child, and that's what Dad did. Not by design, but by being the man he was, and that we all wanted to be his villagers. Our village was all relevant tradespeople, shipwrights, carpenters, cabinet makers, electricians, earthworks and draftsmen. It had houses filled with children and grandchildren. We had daily commuters and never-ending flow of tourists. Tourists were fed and accommodated and welcomed, and there was always room for one more. We ate together most days per week. We holidayed together, but no one felt their space was invaded. When the middle age went to work, the elderly looked after the young, and when they got too old, the young looked after the elderly. The mayor guided us through births, deaths, marriages, divorces, but he continued to look after the village and its neighbours. The mayor may have moved on, but he has left us a hell of a village. My dad knew no strangers. He found the good in everyone he met and always willing to lend a hand to all. I think about all the people that have been in our home, in our life, that are still in my life today, and who remain important to me and the family because of him. When people came into his house to visit, he invited all the kids and grandkids to see them as well, because he wanted us to share in his happiness that friends and other family were here to see him. A lot of you today know exactly what I mean. He's always wanted us to share a beer and a meal, and has always had a lot of fun and laughter around his table. I could be a ratbag when I was younger, but no matter what, he always forgave me, and I was lucky to do my apprenticeship under him and work in a business he created. There is no doubt that I learned a lot about finishing a job properly, treating workmates and workplace with respect. We could talk at length about his career and the skills he required, but at the end of the day, he was a man who retired to be with his grandkids. This was his wealth, and because of he died a wealthy man with no regrets, and he wanted nothing other than us kids to be together. Unfortunately, Dad became ill in 2018, and I had a month sitting beside him in the hospital pretty much every day and night. As tragic as it was that he was sick, it was a time that we learnt so much about each other and shared many laughs that I would never have had the opportunity otherwise. We became so much closer, and has made the last 2 years truly memorable and taught me to appreciate what we have. Thanks, Dad, for making us a happy family. No riches, but you shared everything you had with everyone and that came along, including the extended family and extra grandkids. Thanks, Dad, for having our backs and always supporting us, never judging our actions and carrying us through all the trials that a family faces. Thanks, Dad, for being a great mate and leaving us amazing memories. And thanks, Dad, for taking good care of Mum over the last few years. But rest easy now, because we've got it from here.
Thank you, Shane. Blair, would you like to share?
Anyone who ever spent a little bit of time with Pop knows what a kind-hearted gentleman he was. Always a smile on his face, never a burden to anyone. Pop lived a full life, full of family and friends, kind to everyone he met. No matter how busy he was, he would always make time for everyone, whether it was a quick cup of coffee or jumping in to help with whatever they were doing. When I was 10, Pop retired from work to spend time with us kids, and that's just what he did. On school days, he would make us breakfast, help us get ready for school. He'd even drop us off and pick us up from school. He would help with everything, even the homework. When it came to working, there wasn't anything he couldn't do. And I guess as a boy, I wanted to be just like him. I'd ask Pop if I could build something with him, and it was never a problem for him. I'd spend every weekend at his house following him around, probably driving him crazy, but he'd never say. I just thought those days were the best. And unfortunately for me, there was things that Pop loved, and they were birds and football. If we were busy building something and a bird landed nearby, we'd have to be quiet while he watched it. Then the football would be on at lunchtime and work would stop. This did not sit well with me. I told Pop one day, I hate birds and I hate football. And he has loved to remind me and extend the family of that ever since. Pop was a family man. We knew he cared, but I guess I didn't realise how much until the other day when Mum was going through his bedside table and found a whole heap of cards and letters we had given him over the years. That's many years ago. So who knows what else he has kept. When we were young, we were lucky to receive handmade gifts from him, and these were endure for our children to enjoy as well. The tradition continued with him making cradles and drawing tables and other bits and pieces for my kids. As long as I can remember, Pop had the strongest, fastest and most powerful machine that had ever been made, the Little Red Tractor. As kids, we just thought this machine was the best. With a cigarette in his mouth and a can in his hand, Pop would just walk around with us while we drove and drove that Little Red Tractor. I'm not sure how many kilometres that tractor did, but Pop's legs have sure done the same. When I came home from school one day, improvements had been made. A clutch pedal I could reach, just for me, so I could drive it by myself. Pop, being a tall man like me, knew that it would be quite some time until I could reach those pedals on my own. So as always, he made something out of nothing and I was off on my own. I think this was so he could finally watch the football without me nagging him. Years have passed and I have children on my own, not just a Pop to them, but also a neighbour. The kids got to see him often and were always super keen for a visit. It wasn't too long ago and Pop was out taking them for rides on the Little Red Tractor as well. Pop lived a full life, loved by family and friends. It doesn't seem to matter who met Pop, they all walked away wanting to be more like him. I haven't just lost my Pop, but I've lost a good friend.
Thank you, Blair. Rowan, would you like to come forward and share?
Dynamite comes in small packages, so just be careful, is what Pop would say to those that quipped with him about his height, me included. That always made me smile. A saying about not underestimating the power of something or someone based on their size. I might have joked, but I couldn't underestimate him. I've always seen him as a great man, even though he was so modest. Someone that I should like to aspire to be. He's the strongest man I know with a giant heart who could joke about anything, including himself. As a patriarch of our family, he was a hard worker and a good provider. He went out of his way to make time for us, his grandkids, and at the end of the day, he was the guiding light that brought us all home. He was loved and respected by all, and it seemed to me there was nothing he couldn't do. There was certainly nothing he couldn't build. He has always been a master craftsman and would engineer fantastic things out of next to nothing, traits that I was constantly in awe of, and yet he was so unbelievably humble about it all. I didn't know Pop when he was younger, and it's hard for me to picture him as a young man, no matter how many stories I hear or how many photos I look through. I guess I've always imagined he just appeared as this 60-something-year-old man with greying hair and wrinkles, on the outside anyway. But when you spent time with him, there was no age difference between us. When we were little kids, he was so happy and fun to be around, with little red tractor rides and spending so much time together, he was just another kid. When we were older, he was a friend who you would hang out with as you watched footy or tennis, and you could talk freely about whatever. And as I grew up, our chats about school turned into chats about work, turned into chats about life. I could tell him anything, and we could have a good laugh, or he'd offer me advice or a welcome distraction. He was always happy to see us, always there with a friendly ear, and that helped me to no end. Having a childhood where we lived so close to our grandparents was the best. We were able to see them almost every day. When we were kids, I remember, you'd present Pop with work you'd done, a building project, a drawing or some artwork, a school report, anything at all. And he would study it, and he'd glance at you and back at the work, and then he'd praise it with such enthusiasm that you would beam with pride. Goodness me, that's jolly good, isn't it? Have a look at that, Nanny. When something was good, it was jolly good. And that never stopped with Pop. From school to high school, through to apprenticeships and work, he was so proud, always looking at what we'd done. Even as adults, his was the endorsement that mattered most, and it helped to shape us into who we are today. Now with kids of our own, we were able to see Pop admire a new generation of art and projects and schoolwork. His was still the endorsement we sought for our kids, and he did just that. He praised them with the same enthusiasm, just as he'd done so years before. We got to see the same looks of pride on our kids' faces as he instilled new confidences, and we'd beam right alongside them once again. I will always cherish the things that Pop built for me. They are of such admirable quality and a testament to the artisan that he was, but to me they are so much more. To me, they are Pop's love and support in what I did and the lessons he was teaching me. Sentiments that he expressed with his craft that he didn't need to put into words. Things like my toddler-sized melamine desk that he made me when I was just 3 or 4, for me to sit and draw and paint, something I've always done and that he's always encouraged me to do. Like my drawing board, complete with squares, slides and rules that he made me when I was still in school, where I'd spend hours working on technical drawings and projects that helped steer me into my chosen career. And like my dining table, the place where my family and I gather every night to share our meals and talk about our days and celebrate milestones, where I've watched our kids grow so much. He built that with his bare hands, and he made it big enough for all of us, our friends, our extended families, and our future. Before I'd even met Brooke, Lillian, and Elliot, before I could truly appreciate his subtle message of the importance of family, but now I appreciate it more than ever. It's funny to think that these pieces of furniture, these objects, could be that unassumingly influential at the different stages of my life. And it's so clever and understated, and I like to think a little bit sneaky of Pop in how he's guided me in this way, but I'll be forever grateful for it. Mum had told all of us of Pop's practical jokes before we came along, and when I play the occasional prank on the kids, or when the kids play pranks on me, it brings up memories of him. Perhaps this is Pop's legacy. It reminds me of one birthday, and normally if Pop wasn't giving us a handmade gift, birthday saw Nanny giving us a birthday hug or kiss on the cheek, a loving happy birthday sentiment, and then presents, all going by the card on behalf of her and Pop. I remember one year though, Pop handed me a gift just from him. About the size of a tissue box, maybe a bit bigger, so not likely to have been handmade. Soft packaging, neatly wrapped, no card. He smiled and he said, "Happy birthday, Ro." Well, this was exciting. A latecomer present after I'd opened all of the others just from Pop. It had to be something good. Something Pop deemed so special to go out of his way to get me, separate from all the other presents. I ripped off the paper to see. Just more wrapping paper. I was confused. I looked back to Pop, who seemed to be grinning much wider than before. Hang on a second. I must have unwrapped what felt like 20 layers of paper, but for whatever reason, I thought each layer must be the final one. While the present was getting considerably smaller, in the back of my mind, I was still convinced that something good would be at its centre. Something that had to be worth all that effort. I mean, he was my Pop after all. He wouldn't trick his own grandson. A rookie mistake. It was a single bite-sized Mars bar. He laughed as his hoax had been executed so well. He'd got me. Although I did maybe suspect a collaborator in Nanny, given the quality of the wrapping. I think of Pop when I think of the really simple, everyday things. Like my attempts to build things, and I try and channel thoughts of him working so skillfully and contently in his workshop. I'm at an age where the sun coming through the window onto the couch looks like an appealing place to relax, and it reminds me of Pop's regimented afternoon naps. And I think of breakfast time with our kids. It brings back memories of when we were little, and there were five of us sitting on the front doormat drinking Milo from plastic cups. Memories of early Sunday morning trips to the bakery and then back for breakfast at his place. He'd make toast or eggs any way you could imagine. You'd have baked beans on bread and butter, spaghetti on bread and butter, braised steak and onions on bread and butter, or even sometimes leftover mince on bread and butter, even though the way Pop seemed to have his was more like butter with bread. I think of Pop when I read the newspaper as he did, mostly the comics. Andy Capp, the Wizard of Id, and in particular, Hagar the Horrible. That's what he called me when I was younger. Often a retort to me facetiously calling him an old fart. I think of him when we have bologna sandwiches, and I still reach for a jar of Poppy's Farm Fresh tomato sauce that was always in the fridge. And I think of him on that first real chilly winter's day, the one where you have to rug up with jumpers and long sleeves. That was a sign of the season change when we were little. Pop going from sleeveless button-up shirts to flannels and track pants. He will be greatly missed, but never forgotten. Impossible to forget when I see him every day in so many places. I'm reminded of him when I see the way Nanny looks at family, usually Dad, particularly if that look is to suggest you'll be in trouble. I see him in Mum's altruism and her devotion to our family and togetherness. In Dad, as he seamlessly assumes his new role as Grumps. In Uncle Shane's quick wit and in Blair's strong work ethic and natural talent. I see him in my receding hairline. Thanks, Pop. And I see his mischievous sense of humour already in Elliot and his same cheeky grin in Hudson, Rory and Denver, even though they've only known him for a relatively short while. Pop, you are my friend, my confidant and my mentor. You will always be, Pop or Poppy, an inspiration to me now and forever and such a major influence on my life. I feel incredibly privileged to have been able to spend so many years with you, and the lessons you taught me will resonate with me forever. Though it doesn't mean much coming from a grandson to a grandfather, I've always been very proud of everything you did and everything you have done for us. Thank you for working so hard for us, for being such a great role model, and for loving us all unconditionally. Bye for now, Pop. It's time for you to rest. We love you and miss you now and always.
Thank you, Rowan. Rube, would you like to come and share?
Thank you. Shane asked me if I'd say a few words. Well, I've got a page and a few pages here. Shane, wind me up at 5 minutes. I do carry on sometimes. I'd like to, first of all, mention that in my time growing up, we were all in the nickname bit, and mine was Rhubarb Robert. Horry, when we caught up with Horry, We mainly called him Charlie Boy or Charlie. And there are other names around, but I can't repeat some of them. So I'll carry on now. I just wanted to mention about growing up in Mosman Park. Horry was 2 years older than me, and Desi, his other good mate. And but he would have been in the, he was in the same era, just a little bit ahead of us. We grew up in Mosman's when it was only about two-fifths the size it is now. Half of it was bush. If his older sister Beth was here, she'd agree with me wholeheartedly. Half the place was deep sewerage, the other half pots down the back lane, you know, the old dunny house at the back fence. And of course, some of us would go along the back fence sometimes, not particularly me, but another blonde-headed bloke. I'd get the blame and pull the pan out and empty it in the back lane, I'd get the blame. But growing up in Mosman's was great. We went to Mozzie's school. Horry would have went there, and I always used to say to Horry, I can remember when I was in grade four, Horry, there were about four girls, Anne Bailey, Jane Meadows, and then another, Gwen Cannon, and Raymond Butchard. He used to come in shoes with long socks. I said to Horry, I'll bet your mother decked you out like that. Well, Horry would say, no bloody way. But anyway, I never, when you went to school as kids, you stuck together in your own group. So it wasn't until after school, when we carried on till about the age of 16, that we really caught up and started playing football together. It was in those early days that Mrs. Kennedy, Mrs. Thomas, and Mrs. Stewart, that lived around the corner from Mrs. Kennedy, a good friend of hers for years, Mrs. Snell, and a few others taught us how to dance up at Windy Hall, that was then the St. Barnabas Hall up the top of I forgot the name of it, don't worry. Anyway, it'll come to me. And they taught us how to dance. We're in short pants. Someone hit the piano and away we'd go. Now, during our formative years, it was swimming down the river during the summer, surfing over the beach. We'd have to walk, of course. And in the winter time, it'd be football. And Horry played in the 1949 under-17 Temperance League. They went premiers. I joined in at 1950 as a late starter at 16. We went undefeated grand champions. I played full back and Horry was alongside me in the back pocket. And I can tell you, as his grandkids have mentioned, a bit short, but he was built like a three-quarter brick little house. And he played that way and he was certainly a great bloke to have alongside you. We went grand premiers. We not only won our competition in our grade, but we also played the premiers of the West Perth and the Midland sections and beat them. And we took a trip to Gemelling and beat the senior team up there, the league team, as under-17s. Horry then moved on to ex-scholars, which was under-21. He played in the 1951 team and we went premiers in the 1952 competition. So he had a good innings in footy and he's got a few premierships under his belt. You just have to bear with me while I... Could you grab that page, please? And it's already been mentioned that in 1947, he started an apprenticeship, and that's the first time I heard Henry Buckland. We always knew him, and everyone even today talks of him as Peck, his nickname. And he operated out of a workshop in a backyard not far from where Horry lived. Horry worked on a variety of craft, some of which were the 12-foot international cadet dinghy, one of which was for his good friends Trevor and Ronnie Gray. He actually sailed for a year with Ron. He built 16-foot skiffs, a range of rowboats, and an array of launches. Ray Glanville's here today, and he built a 18-foot or 20-foot launch for Ray's dad. And there's a photo up there in the dining room, Natalie, with Ray's boat coming back under power with his dad that Horry built. Ray brought the photo up for him about 5 years ago. And it was a great boat, according to Ray. He was working there for 4 years and then Peck sold the business, and he was fortunate to pick up a job with Sid Davis, who operated out of Royal Freshwater Bay Yacht Club. While he was there, he decided to build a Desi might help me here, it was either 10 foot or no more than 12 foot surf ski. Now, he built that out of wooden frames, wooden stringers, a plywood deck, and he put canvas around the skin, painted it, and we took it over and launched it over near the Cottesloe Golf Club in front of what was then known as the Dutch Inn. There was a small surf break that day, and thank God it was small. Horry managed to stand up on the board a few times. The rest of us mugs had to sit on the plywood deck, and even then with some difficulty. But he made a great job of that, and then he went on to build two ski boats. The first boat being a plywood boat, 13 feet long. I provided the castings, and Desi Ledger provided the expertise on the Holden motor, which we marinized to make it fit for the ski boat. He then moved after that into the boat called Two Up, and he's got a nice photo at home of Two Up. Next to that photo on his tribute card in his peak cap, and we used to rag him about that because a number of his mates, like me included, were ratings. We went as recruit seamen into the Nashos, came out as ordinary seamen. We'd either sit in our long mess and eat what was given to us, whereas Horry sat with the officers in the wardroom for his meals. So we certainly gave him a ragging on that.
Right.
It's good to have a helping hand here when you get old. I've already mentioned about the boats. And during that 1940 era, when he started his apprenticeship, a few of us had got together and we built some canvas 10-foot yachts. Canvas skin, that is, wooden deck. And we built the Mosman Park, Mosman Junior Sailing Club. And Horry actually did get to sail with his mate Johnny McDavitt in Audacity, a VJ. Now, there's a bit of a story there. Johnny and his younger brother, Ted, always came to fisticuffs in every race. So in the finish, either Teddy walked or Johnny sacked him and Horry filled in for a year. He also sailed for a year with Ronnie Gray in the 12-foot international cadet dinghy. But after that, that was about the extent of his sailing. And we used to say, why don't you sail? You're good. And I even had a chance to sail with him in Viv Downing's Sharpie one day at Safety Bay. We teamed up just for the day. And he said, look, I work on boats all week. Why do you think I'd bloody well sail in them during the weekend? So that was his out.
There you go.
One day I caught a round of the Kennedy household in Violet Street. Walk around the back to knock Mr. Kennedy up from the back door. And there's a heap of pine planks alongside his workshop. Horry comes out and said, what's all the firewood for? Your mum and dad don't light a fire in the lounge room. And he laughed. He said, Roy Smith down at the boat shed wants me to build him two boats. If Shane had seen the timber, he would have laughed. Split, knotty, rough, painted on one side with apple green. Some of you oldies will remember back verandas in those days, painted with the apple green. Anyway, he did build two boats. We actually, some of us got to hold the dolly that's under the boat while he roved the nail over on, peened the copper nail down onto the rove, standing upright, bending in. Sometimes when his back got tired, he'd say, you can have a go now, but whatever you do, don't flatten the rove. We'd say, why? He said, well, if the planks shrink, you can't tighten up the, you'll attest to that. Right, well, that's about that page, thank you. We're getting there. And we can take that one. I was going to mention, when he went down and finished his last year at the Sid Davis workshop, Another mate of ours, Mark Manning, he started his apprenticeship with Sid. And when I mentioned to Mark about Horry, he laughed. He said every time he went to Kalgoorlie for a long weekend, he'd come back buggered and he'd end up sleeping for 2 or 3 days during his lunch break in his car. He was that buggered. And I can attest to that because I was fortunate enough to be invited on one of these so-called trips to Kalgoorlie. And I can tell you, we did as much running around up there as it took to get to Kalgoorlie and back to Perth. And did he know a few jam tarts? He knew a netball full of them, and he knew as many blokes. But we did have a good time, and 2 of us came back buggered. I'll cut a few pages out, Shane. I'm on the page 8 out of 10. I'll cut it short. Yep. We were going to, back in about early, late 50s, Horry, Kathy was working at the Metro Theatre in William Street, and one of her work girls, mates, her father owned a, he didn't own it, he built a bloody squatter's shack at Long Point. So we went down a few times and we decided we'd build one too. We cleared all the sand dunes for us, number one spot. Horry had the ute. We knocked the house over in Mozzie's and got free timber. And lo and behold, Horry decides to go to the UK. So no ute, no Horry expertise, no squatters flat. So Horry goes off. You then know the story. Catches up with Liz. They get married. Now that's another story. Johnny McDowett just happens to be in London on a ship that he's an engineer on. He fills in as best man, and that was that. Home they come. Horry decides all his Mozzie mates and their Sheilas have to meet Liz and the family. We go up to Wembley, we meet up, we have a few drinks, and I eye up old Barney, Liz's dad, and I got him in the corner and I said, "You're having a good look at us. You're wondering whether we're good enough for your daughter, aren't you?" And I said, "It's a two-way street. We're thinking the same thing about Horry, if you're good enough for him." So we both had a laugh and Barney went and got another bottle of beer and we had a drink. It so happened that about 11 years later, Kathy and I bought a house in Wembley, right next door to Mum and Pop Seal, best neighbours for 28 years. We moved down to Mandurah. Kathy's having a talk to Liz and Liz said, "My mum wants to get her hands on you." And Kathy said, "What for?" "Because she wants to murder you." Kathy said, "What for?" For leaving Wembley. Anyway, very quickly, Horry's expertise didn't just stop on boat building. He was into the house exercise. He helped Beth and Ralph with their house. He helped Viv and Maggie Downing. He helped Kathy and I. He was a great help. And all I can say, and I'm going to cut it short now, he was a master boat builder, craftsman, extraordinaire, and our best man. I've cut out on that. He was our best man. And when our second boy came along, it was Barry Charles. And that was in honour of Charlie. Rest in peace, Horry Charles Kennedy. We're going to miss you. Thank you. I cut it short, Sean.
Thank you, Roo. Grant, would you like to come and share? No? Oh, Marie.
Thank you. Yeah, I will. Today, we say goodbye to wonderful man, a true gentleman, Horry Kennedy. There are many, many wonderful memories that pop into my head when I think of Horry Kennedy. A difficult part is trying to remember, but my first vision I have of Uncle Horry is standing in front of me with his stubby shorts and a shirt with the sleeves cut off. This was Uncle Horry's. I got it many years ago. I pinched it, I think. So I wear it at home occasionally. Then I'd see his beautiful smile and he would welcome me with open arms. Uncle Horry treated everyone like family, extremely generous and thoughtful. That's in fact all the Kennedys, my second home. Growing up as a child, many holidays were spent with our good friends, the Kennedys, either in Carnarvon, Geraldton, or Perth. I remember when Uncle Horry, Aunty Liz, Natalie, and Shane were heading down to Perth to visit us. You would always receive an early bird wake-up call. I believe the Kennedys would arrive about 3 a.m., which is not city time, mind you, but it certainly was country time. I would imagine that you too would have had those early wake-up calls from Horry sometime over the years. My brother Grant and myself are so grateful and fortunate to our parents, Des and Pam Ledger, to be lifelong friends of Horry and Liz Kennedy. We too have become lifelong friends of all the Kennedys, and it's a very special bond to have. My father, Des Ledger, would like to say a few words about his good mate, Horry. We know this is very emotional time, so I will speak on behalf of my dad. Dad talks about many holidays they had together in Kalgoorlie. This was generally caused by the need to run in a reconditioned engine or to check out the new purchase, which generally ended up needing an engine overhaul, along with repairs that seemed to be needed on cars those days. I can just imagine Dad and Uncle Horry with their heads under the bonnet, Uncle Horry's legs sticking up out of the ground, head first into the engine. Today, together they build boats, and two being water skis and speed boats. This was the time when water skiing was just becoming popular and affordable, so there were many helpers to ski and to carry out any maintenance that were required. My father has had a lifelong enduring relationship with Horry and all the Kennedys and has said that Mrs. Kennedy was his second mother. I can definitely relate to that, Dad, as Uncle Horry was my second father. Uncle Horry, we are lost without you. You have pathed an awesome family with a loving wife, Liz, and two fantastic children in Natalie and Shane. You watched your children grow, both grow into fine adults with their own families. You became a grandfather and a great grandfather. That's so awesome. Such a beautiful life you have had watching each and every one of them grow and be a big part of your life. Your legacy continues on each and every one of them. We miss you. We love you. You forever in our hearts. Thank you.
Thank you. Natalie, would you like to share?
Okay, he was a great dad. He was an awesome pop and a great grandfather, but for the family he was also a great mate. Everyone wanted to be near him because he was a good man. He was full of fun and laughter and made everyone feel welcome. He was never rich, but everything he had he shared, not only with family and friends, but with random strangers. In almost all instances, these random strangers would go on to be lifelong friends. I remember early on that our family was returning to Carnarvon after some event in Perth, and we came along some people that had broken down on the side of the road. Mum and Dad towed their car into town, and I remember it was about 11 o'clock at night by then. And when we got there, and I can remember them running around getting mattresses and food and insisting that the family stay with us. They finished their family holiday staying in our home, and they became firm friends, visiting off and on over the years. I remember other times turning up for Christmas Day, and there would be complete strangers there, and Dad would have found them at the wharf with nowhere to go for Christmas and insist they spend it with us. Again, firm friends over the years. This is only a couple, but I can assure you that Mum was always stretching a meal for four to a meal for eight, and our house was always full and overflowing with laughter and friends and strangers. My dad was a great practical joker, and growing up would be a battle of wits on who could pull the best joke. His favourite trick was tying the sleeves of my clothes in a knot so that I would be unable to put my arms in when getting dressed. But I would always have my revenge, and one of the things, he always carried an ironed hanky folded into a square. So he had a ritual of shaking it out so that he could use it. So when he was been playing his jokes, I would put a stitch in the corner of the hanky and he'd get to work, have a sneeze and go to shake it out. But he would come home every day and he'd be laughing and knowing I had exacted my revenge. One of his dad's favourite party gifts was a spring in a box full with confetti, chisels and anything that would make a hard mess to clean up. It would be tied with string and when released would push the confetti out with force. I'm sure there's people here today, and I can see Sue and Frank Roach there, who were recipients of such a gift, and generally the only way to eradicate the mess completely was to sell the house. Which I point out he thought that was funnier than ever. Dad was always very strong and physically fit, and he hadn't been to hospital since he was very young. His first operation was on his 86th birthday. He never had an allergy, and I can't remember a time that he was really ill until 2018. When I lived away with the children, both in Perth and Carnarvon, Dad was scared the grandchildren would forget him, and he would travel every fortnight to see them. He was dedicated to a strong relationship with him, and that was an easy decision for me to make to move back to Geraldton. He got his wish, as no pop was loved more. All of the family had been gifted beautiful furniture over the years, including Jarrah tables, chairs, high chairs, baby cradles, chess tables, to name a few. And when his own mother died, Dad used the Oregon out of a very old bed to craft drawing boards for his grandsons and made other amazing furniture for us. He made clinger dinghies as cradles for the grandchildren and great-grandchildren, which will be handed down for future generations. His skills ensure that there will be many generations who can enjoy fine craftsmanship and learn a little of what he meant to us. I consider myself privileged to have been born into this family, to have had my dad as such a great mate, and to know that my brother, his sons, and my beautiful children have inherited his many fine traits. No man could leave a stronger legacy. You can't sum up 87 years in a few minutes, so it is really important to all of us that you come to Golden Pond Retreat and share some of your stories with us. We're sorry for the out-of-town location, but we were unable to cater for any numbers in town and wanted you all to be there. We have arranged a bus and driver for those that want it so we can get you picked up and brought back to town. And we'll be at the venue until late afternoon, so please take a few minutes to come and share a beer and a story with us.
Thank you, Natalie. Ladies and gentlemen, our ceremony for Horry is almost concluded, and we now have to say a loving and fond final farewell to him. We are deeply grateful for Horry's life and for all that life has meant to you. We thank him for the impact of his life on yours. We remember his smile, his frown, and his love of hard work. Remember his strong values, his loyalty, and his love of his family. Horace Charles Kennedy, may you rest in peace. Family, followed by friends, are invited to come forward and say their personal goodbyes and place gum leaves on Horry's coffin. Once you have said your goodbyes, the pallbearers and family will walk Horry to the crematorium. Thank you all for your attendance here today.
May the road rise up to me. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, and the rain fall soft upon your dream. And until we meet again, may God hold you safe. Give shelter in the storm. May the dust be soft beneath your feet, and the dark give rest before the dawn. palm of his hand, safely in the palm of his hand. Many memories. May your death be sweet and full of peace. May your hope last an eternity, and your joy carry on and never cease. And until we meet again, may God
wanted you for life, you and me in the wind. I never thought there'd come a time that our story would end. It's hard to understand, but I guess I'll have to try. It's not easy to say goodbye. For all the joy we shared, all that time we had to spend. If I had one wish, I'd want forever back again. To look into your eyes and hold you when you cry. It's not easy to say goodbye.
Thank you.